boat. And we were saying we were gonna go to. It was like a 40-minute boat ride.
¿Cómo qué tanto tiempo queda aquí en la isla? En la mona.
25 minutes.
25 minutes.
Hey, bro.
Yeah.
Flip it on.
Yeah.
On the boat to La Isla de los Monos, we were just on that big boat over there. And now we're on this tiny boat, just me and Bryan and, what's his name?
¿Y cómo te llamas?
Hugo.
And Hugo. Hey, Bryan and Hugo.
Hugo.
Hugo. So yeah,
and we're just out here.
Vámonos.
Okay, listo.
Amazon rainforest, my friend Bryan and I embarked on a journey traveling 40 minutes up the Amazon River from Iquitos, Peru. Our destination was a small wildlife sanctuary run by a passionate group of volunteers who have dedicated their lives to rescuing monkeys and protecting the fragile ecosystem of the rainforest. This documentary was a milestone for me. It was my first time traveling with the intent to tell someone else's story. And so along the way, there were moments of uncertainty, unpredictability, and times where Bryan and I had no idea what to expect next. So I invite you to stay with us until the end, and most importantly, gain a deeper understanding of these incredible animals and the challenges they face in their environment and our modern world. I hope you enjoy. Instead of heading straight to the Amazon, we chose a path full of unexpected detours, pouring sand out of our shoes in Ica, exploring the ruins of Machu Picchu in Cusco, and enduring a 30-hour bus ride through rugged terrain. We took planes, trains, and even a boat ride to see some penguins and seals. The road to Monkey Island was unpredictable, challenging, and it pushed us far beyond our comfort zones. But that was probably a good thing, as the Amazon was even further out of our comfort zone. So yeah, like an hour and a half into this road trip. So 28 and a half more to go.
Yeah. leaving the airport and getting ready to, and like, well, not really getting ready, but like 2 hours. So we fly to Iquitos to then try and persuade these people at the Monkey Island to let us film this documentary idea we have. But a lot of unknowns kind of with the trip currently, but that's kind of the fun part. I'm going to update the notebook I got, make sure it's ready for when we're on the island. Got cameras, got all of our camera stuff charging. We're locked in. See you in Iquitos.
We just landed in the Amazon.
Yeah, we just landed just now.
Just got off the plane.
You got a water plane.
Before visiting La Isla de los Monos, I wanted to get a better idea of the challenges monkeys face today, and I realized it goes far beyond just individual rescues. While humans have had a long history of keeping monkeys as pets or using them for entertainment, the problems they face now are more pressing than ever. Monkeys are still being trafficked and exploited, especially in countries like Vietnam and India. And they're sold as exotic pets, used in traditional medicine, testing facilities, or even forced into labor farms. In some countries, they're used to harvest coconuts or perform in street shows for tourists. Beyond trafficking, habitat destruction poses a major threat. Deforestation and forest fires are rapidly reducing their natural habitat, and they're pushing entire species to the brink of extinction. These issues aren't confined to one place. It's a global problem, and the Amazon is at the epicenter of it.
We're in Iquitos, Peru. For the next week, we're here for one night, and then in the morning, we go to the office for La Isla de los Monos and get on the boat. And from there, we are literally staying like in the jungle. Like, we're in the jungle now, but tomorrow we're like in the jungle. So, anyway, to be continued.
That's the one right there. I stop. So there's two divisions. This is the first division. The second division is way over there.
Before we left Iquitos, Bryan and I had one afternoon to explore the city, and so we met up with our friend Ronnie, who took us through the local market, which was a bit off the beaten path from the more touristy market. This is where they would sell food, medicine, and even exotic animals, which I was asked not to record during that portion.
So he was saying that his mom and him, like, they would sell like the breakfast foods over in that blue book.
Por acá?
Okay, está bien.
Como les dije, estas son las más peligrosas, pero la compañía.
Ok, está bien.
Este es el 16 de julio, en las mañanas hay mucho movimiento. Hay cuentas bajas, los animales que se consumen acá principalmente. Está aquí en el río.
So he said this area is like pretty much dangerous for the most part, but that's why he wanted us to accompany us during this time. He said, huele como medicina, como aquí.
¿Tienes un
olor de hueso? Acá
viene.
So this is where they sell all the medicine and all that.
Este que viene de la cabeza de Juan, es bueno para el bueno.
Yeah, Fernando was not saying okay, but in the morning, he said all of these streets was packed.
El trago que lo sientes, sí. ¿Sí? Lo sientes participo, sí, sí. Pero lo sientes también la fruta que es el trago.
Sí, yo siento la fruta, yo pruebo la fruta yo.
El RC. Ya, este es el RC, el famoso rompecalzón.
¿Es el famoso?
Rompecalzón.
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 Rompecalzón. So this is called like ripped underwear. Let's give it a slight try.
Es que algunos preparados.
After Ronnie took us around the markets, we sat down for dinner with him, where he explained a little bit more about the culture of Iquitos and the food. We all ate local fish from the river, and then after, he took us to see the nightlife in the downtown parts of Iquitos. Iquitos has a lot of history, and with it being the largest inland city that can only be reached by boat or plane, it presents unique challenges for its residents. Living in the heart of the Amazon rainforest already comes with its own set of hardships, so these people have learned to adapt and thrive despite the isolation and demanding environment. So witnessing this firsthand has given me a much deeper appreciation for the city and the resilience of its people.
One of the employees right now, he's taking us over to the boat right now. Okay, está bien. See a monkey. You see the monkey, Miles?
Yeah. Like, alright, we just got to the island and we got the fit now.
You got the fit on. Island of the monkeys.
Oh, dude. Oh,
yeah, Zeus is volunteer.
Gotcha.
They're coming for the food that I have here. The
lovely
one, that's Benito.
The which one?
The lovely one, right there.
Oh, okay.
That's Flaca, I think that's Diana.
interesting animals, like sometimes our monkeys around here.
So I'm here with Sabrina. We're just chilling out on the front porch. This is our first day at La Isla de los Monos, and Sabrina seems to like me the best. So yeah, basically this place takes in monkeys from anywhere. They take it from science labs, they take it from illegal pet trade, and they'll take even monkeys that were in like the circus. Any form of captive monkey, they'll take. And the goal of the island is to kind of reassimilate them into a group of monkeys, into like a family. So they have a lot of woolly monkeys, and once they have a good family, once they have a good group and they're kind of reestablished into how to live in the wild, then they will release them outside of the island. Although it's an island, it's kind of like integrated into the Amazon, but it's surrounded by water, kind of why it's called an island, I guess. But for example, like with the woolly monkeys, he said it takes 15 total. They have to release 15 at a time to ensure their survival. And so it kind of takes a lot. They have the most, they have all the woolly monkeys. They've only got a few capuchins, but not sure how many that takes to release. But yeah, hopefully as we, you know, continue doing stuff for them and getting to know the people that work here better, get some of their own opinions and interviews. This is Dahlia. She's a woolly monkey that had arrived on the island during our first full day there. Dahlia had been shot in the arm, but fortunately, the bullet narrowly missed her vital veins and bone. Before coming here, she was taken to a vet in Iquitos, who determined it was too risky to remove the bullet, given her young age of only a few months old. Sadly, Dahlia's mother did not survive the ordeal. This is the heartbreaking reality at La Isla de los Monos. When baby monkeys are brought here, it's often without their parents. They must be introduced to a new family and learn the skills needed to survive in the wild. During our time here, Bryan and I were given the responsibility of caring for Dahlia, as well as the other baby monkeys, administering daily medication, food, and ensuring they spent time with the older monkeys to prepare them for life back in the rainforest.
There's so much here. It's like you go to touch him and it's just like so much hair in his body, so tight.
I know.
Do you know this one's name?
I forgot. I don't know if this was Gita, maybe.
Other than taking care of the baby monkeys, we had a whole list of other tasks. We would prepare food for the other monkeys around the island, we would aid in giving tours to the visitors, and we would clean and sweep and do everything needed to keep the place in tip-top shape. I also did a lot of documenting, like a lot of pictures, videos, so many that I have hours upon hours of monkey footage, which I'm not complaining about.
Hey, what the? You got it?
Yeah.
Give him the apple then. Alright, but...
Now I realize seeing a big zoo pen for these monkeys in the Amazon jungle is a bit contradictory to what this sanctuary is all about. But the monkeys in these cages are the alphas. They're the leaders of the pack, the family, and they're a bit aggressive. And to keep that peace on the sanctuary, they had to be separated from time to time. But don't worry, eventually these monkeys will be released with their entire family. On our last day on the island, we sat down with lead volunteer, Yair. He's also a family member and has lived on this island for the last 25 years. He's brought many monkeys back to health, nursing them and releasing them, bringing the population numbers up drastically. His goal is to continue doing this for the rest of his life and ensure a better environment and ecosystem for the future.
You okay, man?
All right.
I'm ready. All
right, sweet.
Well, I started this project when I was 10 years old. I worked in this project 25 years. So Monkey Island is the rescue center. This project has 26 years. But the first 12 years before to bring those monkeys, we planted different types of the fruits. Before we prepared the harvest first, and then we bring the animals. The problem we have every day here, in the jungles, the people, they don't think about the future. They think just for the dates. So that is one of the problems we have in the Amazon rivers. But the Monkey Island is not only take care of monkeys, also we are taking the environment too. Because here we are reforesting, we are planting for the future. But the people that live in the jungle, they don't reforest, they're catching trees off every dates. And also they are contaminating the rivers. That we have a problem every day in the hour in the jungles. So Monkey Islands, the aim is this animal, they back at the forest again. But not all of these animals we have here in this project, they come back at the wildlife again because they spend too much by humans. But there are someone that can do it. From the government, just we have permission, also we have the paper, but that's all. But we don't receive support from the government.
Jeez. 27 años. This tree is 27 years old, and you, Iro, was the one that planted this. I think it's ginormous now.
Mm-hmm. So what's the biggest challenge you think you face in the future, and what do you want people to know that watch this?
Okay. The biggest challenge we have here is this animal to see in the wildlife. In the wildlife, in the future, also to do education environments with the communities, with the child. Teach them to take care of the environment. Because if you don't teach them, it's like you work too hard here to rescue this animal, to take care, and in case you want to release in one place and the people don't take care about that, probably your work is like it's gone again. So that is the challenge. Our dream, this project, is to see, especially the woolies monkeys. We have a lot of woolies here. They back at the wildlife again, but not in this island. We need to move from here and to put another place.
Yeah. I guess, and we'll end it with what if you could share one of your most favorite memories from being here over the last 25 years.
Oh man, that's a good question, man. My favorite is like to see animals happy in the trees, not in the cage. When they rescue a new one, because the new one, they need a love, good take care, good food. When they look happy, moving, jumping in the group. So that is one of the, I like to do that, to see happy animals. No more in the cage or tied normally. When they rescue someone, find this. Yeah, man.
Thank you. Oh, I appreciate it.
Thank you. They're welcome.
Gotta hop on the boat back to Iquitos. About like an hour boat ride. But hey, quite the experience that was, yeah?
Oh yeah.
This is our boat pilot.
boat conductor. And that's it. Catch y'all back in Iquitos.
Our time at La Isla de los Monos was quick, but it was eye-opening. It's incredible to see the dedication of these volunteers who work tirelessly every single day to give these monkeys a second chance at life in the wild. But the challenges facing the Amazon go far beyond the stories we've shared with you today. This vast rainforest, often called the lungs of the planet, is threatened daily by forest fires and deforestation. And currently, it is experiencing some of the worst wildfires it has seen in the last 14 years. The illegal wildlife trade is not just about the monkeys, but for countless species that call this place their home. So the survival of the Amazon depends on the efforts of those who are willing to stand up and protect it, like the volunteers here at La Isla de los Monos, as well as people like Paul Rosalie, the founder of Jungle Keepers. It is not just about saving one animal at a time, but preserving an entire ecosystem for the future generations. I hope this film has given you a glimpse into the urgent need for action and inspires you to get a little more involved and learn a bit more that could potentially help make a difference. The Amazon's future is in our hands. Thank you for watching.